Awesome. So this is our initial equation, and we're going to try to figure out which one is our acid and which one is our base moving forward. So we have sulfur over here, and sulfur is kind of alone with one bond, and so we're going to have three lone pairs, which is going to give us a negative formal charge over here. And so we know this is going to be our base. And over on the right, we see that nitrogen has two hydrogens. And because of that, we know that one hydrogen is actually going to be attacked by the base on the left-hand side. So we know this is going to be the acid. And one of the lone pairs on sulfur is going to come over and attack one of the hydrogens on nitrogen and bring it over to the base. And the bond that's between nitrogen and hydrogen is going to break as well, and there's going to be a new lone pair on nitrogen. And so down below, forgive me, but I've already drawn the conjugate acid and the conjugate bases for this. So as you can see, I've attached the proton over to sulfur, which has now two lone pairs and hydrogen, and so it now has a neutral charge. And over here, nitrogen only has one hydrogen bond now, so it has two lone pairs, which is going to create a negative charge, negative formal charge. And so we know that this is going to be our conjugate base. And on the left, it's going to be our conjugate acid. And so now that we have kind of knowing where the protons are going and our conjugate bases and acids are, we need to determine which one is kind of the stronger of the bases, which way the equilibrium is going to go. And so first we're going to look over at the atom effect of REO. And if you look over, we have sulfur and we have nitrogen with our negative formal charges. Unfortunately, on the periodic table, we have oxygen in between sulfur and nitrogen. So electronegativity is not going to be able to really define which base is the stronger of the two. And so we do have to move into the R for REO, which is resonance. And so there is a structure we can make on our reactant side. And so we can actually move one of the lone pairs in and make a pi bond, and we can then take one of the pi bonds with oxygen and make it a lone pair, and so we will now have a new resonance structure. And the resonance is just kind of the dispersion of the negative charge throughout the molecule. And so we have two resonance structures for oxygen. Unfortunately, we can't move forward into kind of pushing it into the helix because there is actually an oxygen. So you can't see it, they already have the octet rule kind of formed for carbon, so we can't have any other resonance structures without breaking the rules for our initial base. So we move over into the other structure, and so I'm just going to draw it over here. And so we can actually take one of the lone pairs and make it a pi bond, and then again take one of the pi bonds in oxygen and move it to the lone pair. So we'll have three lone pairs, and then a nitrogen will have a pi bond, and we'll have one lone pair still with a hydrogen. And so with this change, there is again two resonance structures. We can't move forward because there is already four bonds with that carbon. And so we can't stop here because resonance structure, they're both the same for both atoms and molecules. And so we can look at the inductive effect. And though carbon and fluorine are not attached to where the negative charge is, it actually kind of pulls the negativity towards them. And so as you can see, fluorine, as you move across and up on the periodic table, actually has a lot more electronegativity than chlorine. And so we can tell that because of the inductive effect with fluorine, that the conjugate base is the strong base. Is the weaker base, that will actually be the stronger acid because it is more stable, because it can kind of redirect and stabilize that negative charge throughout that molecule. And so moving forward, we can tell that this is going to be our weak base, which makes this our strong base and our strong acid, and then it will be our weak acid down here. So we have two strong acids and bases with two weak bases and acids with the reactant. And because the inductive effect does pull it down here to be more stable, we know that the equilibrium is actually going to force the product to kind of outweigh the reactant side. And so we can then move forward, and the product side would actually be lesser in that. And then we also know that the pKa is with these two acids, because this is a stronger acid, this would actually have a lower pKa, then this would be a higher pKa because it's weaker of the two acids.